we continue on in the month of January with our 7-day fast, you know that we are engaged in this because of you. We're doing it for you. The Lord put it on my heart to do the 7-day fast this month because He's desiring for you and me and everybody that's part of Heritage Church to draw closer to Him this year. He wants everybody to. It's just not limited to Heritage people. But if you're watching online, God is desiring you to draw closer to Him this year because He wants to engage with you in giving you this opportunity to do so, to allow the Lord to show you things that you don't know, to show you things that you need, but you're not sure how to acquire the things that you need. And there's only one way to acquire them, and that is through our Heavenly Father. Especially, He wants to show you how much He loves you and how much He cares for you. Amen, church? Its purpose is for us to draw closer to the heart of our Heavenly Father, so that you really, really, really get to know Him. He already knows you inside and out. He knows every hair on your head. He knows everything about you. He shaped you and formed you before He even placed you into your mother's womb. He knows you. He created you. He knows your coming ins. He knows your going outs. He knows all the affairs of your life from beginning to end. Amen? But He wants us to know Him. And unfortunately, the modern-day church, I don't know, maybe all through history, we don't really, because especially in America, we're so busy, we don't take the time to set aside to spend time with Him, quality time with Him, so that we can get to know Him in the way that He desires for us to know Him. And so that's what this 7-day fast is all about, to give you an opportunity to really see the heart of God when you sit with Him on a day that you're fasting and you're taking time to be with Him and you're engaged in His Word and you're praying to Him, talking to Him in prayer. And you do this, you know, by, as I said last week, you put the dogs and the cats outside, lock the door, hide your cell phone, all outside interference. How many of us understand that the devil wants to interrupt that time every time? The doorbell will ring. All this weird stuff happens when you want to set some time aside to be with the Lord. Amen? You ever had that happen to you? So you need to, like, think about and be conscientious about anything that can distract you. You don't need your cell phone when you're talking to God. He hears you. So just put it in the other room and turn it off. Amen? And so this is a time when we can really spend great time to be with Him and to get to know Him. And as you develop this habit, of seeing God touch you and speak to you in different ways during those 7 days that you choose to fast and pray and sit with Him, as you see the presence of the Lord, the peace of God that's going to come on you and show you things, as I say, that you don't know that you need to know. And when you see this, hopefully you will continue to desire to go to that secret place, that special place, and spend time throughout the year. Not just these 7 days, but as many days as you possibly can. Even if you took one day out of the week and you just said, you know, Lord, I'm gonna set aside several hours just to be with you on one day every week for the rest of the year. And you just have your Bible, pen, and paper, right? And you begin to talk to Him in prayer. You begin to speak to Him. You begin to praise Him. You begin to just talk to Him and thank Him for all that He's done in your life. read the Word. Go back and pray. Read the Scripture some more. Go back and pray. Read the Scripture some more. And if you dedicate that time to Him during that time, all of a sudden, unbeknownst to you, you're going to start taking some notes because God's going to begin to speak to you. Whether He speaks to you through His Word by revealing to you some passages of Scripture you're reading, and all of a sudden they become illuminated, and you start receiving this revelation of what God is trying to get through to you. Or sometimes when you're doing that, He speaks to your inner man. Amen? He speaks to your spirit man down inside here. And you just know down in your knower that God is showing you some things because you know that it's the Spirit of the living God that is communicating with our spirit. Amen? And so when you develop this skill, and it is because you have to desire to want to do that. You have to be dedicated to that. You have to participate in getting to know God. You can't just say, I want to get to know God, and I really don't know you that well. I've been a Christian for a number of years, and you know, I'm not having an understanding of the Scripture that much. You have to pursue the Lord in that manner. You have to be a God chaser. You have to chase after God. You remember the story in the Bible about the woman with the issue of blood? She had the issue of blood for many, many years. Something going on with her blood. Doctors and witch doctors and all the people that she went to see could not help her. Then she heard about this man named Jesus who was praying for people and healing the sick and casting out devils. And he came into her town. She heard about him. There was a huge crowd gathered around Jesus. Just she couldn't get in. And so what she did is she says, I'm getting in no matter what. If I could just get near him, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know he'll heal me. And she pressed through. She pushed in. She, excuse me. You ever been to an airport and somebody does that? They want to get in line and they just push you out of the way. And, you know, that's what this woman with the issue of the blood was doing. When she got to Jesus, she touched him. Just couldn't get close enough to touch him, but she grabbed a hold of the hem of his his gown. And Jesus, he said, I feel the virtue of my healing power leave me and go into her. She chased him down. That's the same thing that you and I need to do. She was a God chaser. And we need to be God chasers. Amen? So its purpose is for us to draw closer to the heart of our Heavenly Father so that you really get to know what God is like. And I want to spend some time this morning sharing with you some scriptures about what He's really like, because when you really get to know Him, you will desire to spend more time with Him. I'm going to take you back some years when you met the love of your life. Remember that? This couple right here wasn't that long ago. But you can remember when you met the love of your life and you just said, man, I got to figure out how I'm going to get to know that man or that woman. And so you pursued that person. And then once you got to know them and you saw a little twinkle in their eye, just like the twinkle you had in your eye, then you desired to spend more time with them. You called them every day, a couple times a day. Started taking them out all the time. You wanted to be around them all the time. You were desiring to get to know them because the time you spent with them was, like, really cool. Amen? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 and 16, it says, "For we do not have a high priest," and speaking about Jesus, "who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Let me explain what the author of Hebrews is saying here. He's saying that Jesus knows and he feels what we go through. The ancient Greek meaning for the word sympathize that we use in our English language literally means to suffer along with. Jesus is suffering along with you when you're going through stuff. So when it says Jesus sympathizes with our weaknesses, he gets so engaged with you and with what's going on in you and in your life that he suffers alongside of you. Isn't that amazing? And then in verse 16, he invites us to come boldly to the throne of grace. Now listen, Satan discourages us to come to the Lord, and he wants us to believe that the Lord is unapproachable. I'm glad you agree. But the Bible clearly tells us that Jesus encourages us to come to him, to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Oh, by the way, boldly in that verse does not mean that we come to the throne proudly or arrogant and presuming that he's going to do something for us. Boldly means we come constantly to the throne without reservation, knowing that the door to the throne is always open. We come freely without having to throw up any fancy words or fancy prayers. We come to the Lord with confidence and persistence, like the woman with the issue of blood. And when we do, we can be thankful that God provides help in our time of need. That's what the author of Hebrews is explaining to us. I want us to look at Psalm 145, verses 8 and 9. And here's what it says. "The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. He's slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works." That's what God is like. The psalmist is explaining it to us. In Exodus chapter 34, verse 6 and 7, "And the Lord passed before Moses and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin." There's our God again. Matthew 11:28. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest." Come to me. It's an invitation. God keeps inviting us over and over and over again throughout the Scripture to come to him. He wants to be with you. He wants to sup with you. He wants to spend time with you. Don't leave him hanging. Over and over again in the Scriptures, we see the Lord encouraging us to come to him. Amen? Psalm 103, verses 13 and 14. It says, "As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed, and he remembers that we are dust." So God has, he has compassion on you. You're one of his kids, right? Psalm 145:18. "The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth." So I want us all to see how much the Lord desires for us, his children, his kids. to come to him with anything and everything. No matter how big or no matter how small the matter may be, God wants you to come to him. He wants to hear about it. He wants you to talk to him about it. God wants to, you to come to him and talk to him. We just read that, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace and help from him in our time of need. Simply said. But we make it difficult to understand, don't we? Or to participate in. And when you come to him, you should know that he cares for you and he cares about what you're going through. He really does. Why? Because as we read in Hebrews 4:15, he is able to sympathize with our weaknesses because he's willing to suffer alongside with us. He feels our pain. He understands our concerns and everything that troubles us. He wants us to come to him and talk about it. Get it off our chest. Does it mean that when we are not troubled with anything that we don't come to God? Forbid not. He just wants to spend time with us. And when you get a clear picture, a clear understanding of what that is and what that means, then you will not be able to go a day without having this intimate fellowship with our Lord. That's what the 7-day fast is all about. And when God has placed a dream in you, when God has placed a vision in you or a concern about something inside of you that only he can make come to pass, you need to fast and pray. Listen, what's in you will always come out when you fast and pray. It'll always be revealed when you fast and pray. Maybe the Lord has put something in you that he wants you to fast and pray. It might be concerning your spouse or a financial situation or a family member, a child, something concerning your job or your church. He's put it on your heart. But you can't figure it out. You're not getting any answers. Well, it's time to fast and pray and spend some time with the Lord. If you've been carrying that burden around in you, it will come out when you fast and pray. Remember when Jesus' disciples were trying to cast out demons and they couldn't cast them out? And Jesus came and they said, why couldn't we cast them out? And he said, this kind only comes out through fasting and praying. Same principle. It's a biblical principle. Exodus chapter 34, verses 27 and 28. It says, then the Lord said to Moses, write these words, for according to the tenor of these words, I have made a covenant with you and with Israel. So he was there with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate nor drank water for 40 days and 40 nights, neither ate or drank water. And he wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. God gave him the Ten Commandments. This was a supernatural fast that was ordained by God. 40 days and 40 nights, you guys, without food or water. Yeah, I don't recommend anybody trying to go without water. It's supernatural. That's why he could do it. I got to tell you a story about one of our former church secretaries several years ago. she was going through some real difficult times. It was in 2008 when the financial crisis came again, and they were losing their home. Her husband was a real estate that was in real estate. He was making a lot of money. She was our church secretary, and their kids were not living according to godly principles. And she was very concerned, and she came to me and she said, "Pastor, I feel like the Lord's calling me to go on a 40-day fast." I go, "Are you sure?" And she goes, "Yeah." And she did. So all she drank was liquids. 40 days. Shortly after the fast ended, she gets a call from, what's the ministry? Christian Broadcasting Network. And she was a CPA, and they offered her a job. They offered her husband a job at the college there. What's the pastor's name that heads that? Pat Robertson. And he also has a college there. And so her husband went to work for the college. She was a CPA. They moved to Virginia. The kids got right with the Lord. It was a miracle that happened. But it happened because she dedicated 40 days of her life fasting and praying. It was a real troublesome time. We hated to see her leave, of course. But now they're both doing very well financially and every other way. The kids, both their kids are married and have children now, and they're serving the Lord. In the book of Esther, when Haman ordered the annihilation of all the Jews, Esther called all the Jews of her city to join her on a 3-day fast from all food and water. Again, 3 days. You could probably do 3 days. Only if the Lord calls you to do that without water, then you can do it because he'll get involved supernaturally. But otherwise, I would drink water, liquid. Amen? You can go without food, no problem, for 3 days. So Esther called all the Jews of her city to join her in this 3-day fast, and they went without food and water. She sent a message. You remember, you good Bible students know this story. She sent a messenger to Mordecai and told him, "Go gather all the Jews." This is in Esther chapter 4:16. She says, "Go gather all the Jews who are present in Shushan and fast for me. Neither eat or drink for 3 days, day or night." So she called them to a fast. The Lord put it on her heart. And as a result of this fast, all the Jews were spared, and Haman's wicked plan was exposed, and then they hung Haman on the very gallows that he built to hang Mordecai on. Here's another testimony in the Bible of fasting and praying. King Darius was tricked into signing a law that put his friend Daniel in all kinds of danger. The law that he signed proposed that for 30 days, no one could pray to God or ask any deity for help other than the king himself. Couldn't go to any gods. He couldn't pray. Couldn't pray to any idols or any deity, but only the king. That's who they could pray to. This group of people tricked them into signing it. The men who wrote the law knew that Daniel prayed to the Lord, the only true God, 3 times a day. And they knew that they could trap Daniel if they could get the king to sign this law. And he did. He got tricked into it, deceived him. You can read about this in Daniel chapter 6, I think, verses 4 through 10, or right in that area anyway. But the punishment for praying was to be cast into a den of lions. And, of course, Daniel got caught praying. And so he was brought before the king, who had no other choice but to honor the decree in which he signed. And King Darius said that he hoped Daniel's, because they were friends, and he said that he hoped that Daniel's God would be powerful enough to save Daniel from being eaten by these lions. And then in Daniel chapter 6, verse 18, here's what it says. It says, now the king went to his palace, and he spent the night fasting. And the Bible doesn't say what kind of fast it included, but it seems to indicate that it was more than just food, because in that same passage of Scripture, it says that the king did not allow music to be played that night, and that he did not sleep. So he didn't want any distractions. He just wanted to fast and be in the presence of Daniel's God. And the next day, when King Darius heard that Daniel had survived from being cast into the lion's den, Darius proclaimed that Daniel's God was the only true God. And the king even declared that God's power was greater than all the kingdoms on the earth, and that God's kingdoms would be established forever and ever. King Darius decreed that. He claimed that. He proclaimed it. Last week I mentioned to you guys three things that every Christian should do, which was every Christian should give willingly, generously, and cheerfully. Every Christian should pray, and every Christian should fast. And last week I taught on the importance of giving cheerfully and willfully. I'm going to spend this next portion of today's message on the importance of praying. Prayer, you guys, isn't just about asking God for things you need and things you desire. It's about establishing a relationship with Him that is built on faith and trust in Him. It's like you talk to your spouse or someone close to you. You can trust them, and so you share things that you wouldn't share normally with other people, right? Same thing with God. It's built on faith, prayer is. It's built on trusting Him. You can get away in your prayer closet. You could talk to Him about things that you wouldn't talk to anybody else about. God knows the desires of your heart long before any of us even think to ask. But He still wants and He still loves to hear from you, whether you are asking for guidance or giving thanks to Him, because it draws you closer to Him. The Bible, you guys, is filled with testimonies of people who were led to pray for a variety of things in their life that we still pray about today. The Bible's filled with those things that you and I pray about all the time, because nothing changes. Fear, anger, worry, finances, guidance, and relationships. That's why the Bible is full of verses concerning these things. But concerning those dark days, those difficult times in our lives, when you're questioning how effective prayer really is, these Bible verses will help motivate you to get down on your knees and communicate with the Lord. The first one is in Proverbs 15:29. And here's what it says. It said, the Lord is far from the wicked, but hears the prayer of the righteous. Hallelujah. Praise God. God draws near to those of us who draw near to Him. If you don't draw near to Him, phooey. And the prayers that come from you, the prayers that come from me, that go up to Him, are effective prayers, and He hears them. Did you know that? James 5:16 says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. James puts a lot of emphasis on prayer. When you read the book of James, you'll see that he puts a lot of emphasis on prayer. And here, he urges us to confess our trespasses to one another and to pray for one another that you may be healed. James' statement that effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much is related to healing, this particular birth. And what do you need to receive a healing for? Whatever you need to receive a healing for, I should say. It is for some sort of sickness that people have. Or maybe it's an emotional healing that you need, caused by a relationship, or you had that person that was in your life and they did something that hurt you. Maybe you need a healing for that. Many of these types of things might be rooted in sin. The Bible talks about that. The original Greek word translated as sick is the passage of Scripture that it's referring to is an illness. It's referring to an illness. God is the healer and the source of all healing. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 26, God says, I am the Lord, your healer. And when you're sick, you need to seek him in prayer because he is the Lord, your healer. It's okay if you go to the doctor, but you should always put more faith and trust in the Lord God Almighty because he said, I'm your healer. Now, whether he chooses to go through medicine or all the technology that he gave man the wisdom to create, that's fine, but you need to acknowledge the fact that he's the healer. You need to call upon the elders of the church to pray for you. James 5, 13 and 15. It says, if anyone among you is suffering, let him pray. Is anyone cheerful, let him sing songs. Is anyone among you sick, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he'll be forgiven. So James suggests that sometimes sickness is the result of unconfessed sin. He does not say that every sickness is the result of, or the consequence of sin. That's not what he's saying. Only that some may be rooted in sin. Some sicknesses are rooted in sin. Many others are not rooted in sin. If this is the case, we are to confess our sins to one another so that God will forgive us. In other words, you go to the person that you're holding this thing against or you have a problem with and you ask them for forgiveness. We're going to have like a true repentance of our sin. If we did something and offended somebody and it created a problem in a relationship, in a family member, something like that, then you need to go to that person and ask for forgiveness. If they did something to you, and you reciprocated back with something that you shouldn't have done as a Christian, you need to go to that person. You need to ask for forgiveness. That's what James is talking about. He's not talking about confessing your sins before a priest. He's not talking about confessing your sins to a bunch of people. Some people do that. They wear their emotions on their shirt sleeve and they just blah, 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 blah about everything that's going on in their life. He's not talking about that. He's not giving also a blanket promise of healing. He is presenting this practical advice to us. The word avails in the Greek, it means that prayer produces an advantage. It means that earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. It has an advantage. If you don't pray, there's no advantage. The fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. It gives you an advantage over people that do not pray. It means that the prayer of a righteous person is able, it's capable, and it has power. Now listen, prayers that are powerful and effective come from righteous people. 1 Peter 3:12 says, "For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers." Did you know God's eyes are on you? Day and night? The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. And his ears are open to your prayers. But if you don't pray, what's the result of not praying? Not going before the Lord? He's going, "Man, I don't know what's wrong with that person." They should know that's all they got to do is come to me and talk to me about what's going on. And I can help them. Because I'm able. I'm able to help. I'm able to be there with you. I'm able to help you through these things. It gives you an advantage when you go talk to God in prayer. God's heart is for you to seek him and speak to him, you guys. His heart is longing to receive your prayer request. I remember years ago when I watched some of these big ministries on television, they would always say, "The prayer lines are now open. Call this number and we have people waiting to pray for you." You remember that? Well, I want you to know that God's prayer lines are open 24/7. And he's anxiously waiting to hear from you. Won't you spend some time with him and talk to him about your concerns and make your request known to him? He's waiting for you to do that. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says this, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God," when you do this, here's the outcome. "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." You should be shouting on that. Come on, let me hear you say amen, church. "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, prayer and supplication." In everything, prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. In your request, make your request known to God. And when you do that, and when you take time and you sit with God, this is what I was talking about earlier. When you spend that quality time with God, and you talk to him in prayer, and you open your Bible, and you take notes, and you're in there with him, it says, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind through Christ Jesus." Come on, church. Give them a shout this morning. Hallelujah. Paul says, "In everything, with prayer and supplications, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God." Everything? Everything? Nothing is too small or too big for God. God already knows all of our needs, and he already knows our requests, but he requires participation from us on our part. He's waiting for your participation to make your requests to him. He's waiting for you to do that. And we are to offer these prayers to him with thanksgiving. Because when we do, it guards against us whining and complaining in our prayer life. So we would just thank him. "Thank you, Father, for everything you've done in my life. Thank you for," you know, just start remembering things that he's done. "Thank you for this. Thank you for this time when you did that. I thank you for this time. And Lord, I have a request now that I'm going to make for you because you're able. And I'm going to do it with a thankful heart. So Lord, here's my request for right now." And you share that with him. And when we do these things, The Bible says that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. This kind of peace that it's talking about is beyond the power of our own thinking. We can't even think about what kind of peace that is. It's not throwing up a couple peace signs and saying, "Peace, brother." It's beyond our comprehension. It surpasses all of our understanding, the Scripture says. It is the absolute contentment of God's love on you, overflowing you. And you're just like, "Oh, I don't want to leave. I got some stuff I got to do, but I don't want to leave your presence today, Lord." My friends, this is why when we fast, we are to mix it with prayer. We are to get along with God. We're to open our Bibles, to have a pen and some paper. Pray, read the Bible, pray, read the Bible, pray, read the Bible. God will begin to speak to you at some point, either through His Word or down in your inner man. If you're blessed enough, He might even speak to you audibly. God will begin to speak to you probably through, as I said, the Scriptures, or the still small voice in your inner man, and show you things that you need to do. Show you things that you need to know, that I see it now. It comes so clear to me. Why didn't I see that before? Because you never talked to me about it. He'll show you things that you need to know. And then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your mind through Christ Jesus. Can I get an amen this morning? That's my message.